use it to string other other applications together along the way to solve real problems. And then we'll open it up for some questions in the third half. Just go to presentation mode here. So you know who we are. This is actually just a presentation from a previous conference. But we'll be doing all the exercises live. Just a quick plug for projectvasari.com. If you're on the webcast and you haven't gone here, take a look at it. There's some really interesting new questions and things happening in the forums that we like to see on a daily basis. And if you have kind of a burning question about why something works a certain way in conceptual modeling tools or with the analysis results or now with some of the new works in progress developments that we have, that's the best place to ask these questions. For example, a guy was asking about how to do stadium seating layout using Dynamo, and it was a great long conversation about exactly how to do that, doing something very computational and that would ordinarily require scripting to do, but doing it in a non-scripting sort of visual way instead. So where did this thing come from? A friend of mine, a friend of ours named Ian Keough, who used to work at Burrow Happold and was also part of a company called Vela, now acquired by Autodesk, started this particular thing called Dynamo a little bit more than a year ago as really a kind of an interesting science experiment to solve some of his own needs and to solve what he saw as a really interesting market opportunity out there. That said, he was like, look, I've got a day job, I'm developing software, I've got a lot of things that are going on, I've got a family, I don't know what to do with this thing. So we had a long conversation and Ian decided to open source his little effort here as a plugin that can be run on top of Revit and Vasari, but not being developed by Autodesk per se. It's available under an open source license and anybody can contribute to it. So you can download the code, you can use it. And what we've been doing inside of Autodesk is contributing to that open source effort on top of Revit and on the top of Vasari to build out new features, new functionality over the last, actually, 9 months now. So we taught a class, Zach and I taught a class at AU 2011, this past November, and that's what we're looking at here. That was really about building energetic supermodels is what we were playing with. Energetic supermodels is what the name of the class that we had. And it was really about connecting, using Dynamo to create additional references and relationships between objects and to take the results from something like an analysis workflow and then feed them back into a parametric model. So you can drive that model with the results and essentially tune that model to do things that Revit doesn't have hard-coded into it. So you can customize what you want to do based on your project needs or the goals of any research that you have. So since then, we've taken this a lot farther. We have people inside the company here that have been contributing further into this effort and added more features and functionality into Dynamo. So now it's kind of, phase two of this exercise, and we launched a new version of it right around in time for the Revit Technology Conference in the end of May, early June this year. So here's the kind of stuff that we're going to talk about today. As we mentioned, we're going to talk about what type of feedback loops you can make, how to actually author a parametric model, and if you've tuned into the previous Vasari talks, you should be pretty familiar with these concepts. So I'll go through those fairly quickly. And then the third part is really getting into the actual visual programming environment. And then the fourth is an example of how to actually build this feedback loop where this thing will automatically essentially optimize based on a set of goals and criteria that you have. So what are we talking about as far as analysis and geometry here? Well, the high-level problem, just even in architecture, is, look, you've got some environment, and you have a building design that you're trying to place in that environment. So how does the environment influence the building, and how does the building influence the environment? High-level problem, doesn't really require any computation to figure that out. But computation can help us understand, instead of just intuit, what the right answer might be. So kind of the basic way people are doing these things today is you build a geometric model, you might do some level of analysis generically, could be energy, could be structure, could even be something like pulling out area takeoffs, even like in old school AutoCAD days of drawing polylines around something to extract an area. So you take some geometry, you analyze it at some level, you extract some data, some meaningful data, and you try and make a design decision, and then you change your design. And then out of that feedback loop comes a quote-unquote optimal design that you then go forward and document and build. So what we have now with the advent of more and more computational power and, you know, parametric modeling, integrated analytical capabilities is a way to smooth out that workflow and make it actually be a little less, you know, sort of chaotic, a little less prone to error, and it'll take a lot less time. And the way we do that is really kind of looking at the best of something like the Revit technology or things that are in Vasari and how we can take the results of analysis and not just look at them graphically, but feed the data back into the parametric model. So basic idea is you have smart components, like logic that you build into a family, and then you use some way to create additional relationships and feed information back into that model so that it can regenerate itself and recreate itself based on that information. And then from that, of course, the documentation still flows out. So quick stuff here. I mean, you know, this information is really kind of the heart of the building information model. And you can look at it in a couple different ways. Of course, you know, looking at the actual data in a schedule or looking at things graphically or pushing information, you know, back into different instances in the model. Like in this case, figuring out how to scale up and down an aperture inside of a piece of curtain wall. So let's talk about how these models get authored. And these models, that's why we're calling them supermodels, they're actually really interesting and powerful, but they can be somewhat frail and moody is really the best way to describe that. So these things, they will behave in a lot of different cases, but they can also be break. They can break and be somewhat fragile in certain cases as well. So when you're talking about these things, you need to think about what type of component you're making. You know, think about it as far as, am I making something that's the building scale or down at the scale of, you know, a piece of curtain wall or a piece of shading device? And then what do I want to control? You know, what level of flexibility do I actually need in this parametric model? And then more importantly, kind of what information am I looking to take in from the outside and then drive through the model with a series of formulas or relationships? So, you know, if you're familiar with some of the things that we've talked about in previous Vasari talks, the way these things usually work is some level of parametric mass family or an adaptive component or a curtain wall-esque thing that you have, or essentially a rig that geometry is based on. And then you have a set of sort of driving parameters that we can talk about. And then there might be some other related parameters that are used to calculate intermittent values. And as far as rigging, this is a great slide from Zach before. It basically just comes down to, you know, you don't have to get scared about the math. It really comes down to some geometric principles. You know, is this thing perpendicular to this other thing? Some basic trigonometry. If you remember SOHCAHTOA from, you know, trigonometry or algebra class, that's really pretty much the math that you need. And then some other basic simple equations. But you don't actually need to be that heavy in math do this, either on the parametric modeling side or in the Dynamo side, which we'll talk about in a second. But you do need to think about what your goals are and how you're going to express that information. So from a parameter standpoint, you have to think about what's going to be driving what and how should they relate. And then you can actually break down a lot of these problems into families inside of families or nested families, not only to smooth out the way things work, but actually it makes it more, it abstracts the problem so you can think about, okay, not just, you might not see 20 parameters at once, you might just see 5 and then have other ones that are nested inside that are doing certain things. So the basic idea is, you know, if you can understand points and lines and work planes, a little bit of math, and then, you know, for your users, you'll hear a lot less whining about these things. So just a little bit about data and data normalization. Especially when it relates to analytical results, these things can have interesting units. You know, things like kilobtu per square foot per year. You know, that can have exceedingly large ranges. So you have to kind of think about the data that you're getting back, what units it's in, and what kind of ranges can you expect. So you could have something that's trying to go from, say, 0 to 1 to open itself up like an aperture, but it might have to deal with values that are, you know, from 0 to 10,000 or 20,000. So how, you have to kind of think about how to clamp some of those down and interpret the results that you're getting back, which in some cases is somewhat of a trial and error case. You know, you might get a certain, you might get a particular model that works well looking at a particular day of the year, but once you take it to the full year calculations, like in the case of solar insulation, you're going to get significantly different values. So how is your model going to resolve if you feed those in? A little bit about the data sources involved. So if you guys have seen some of the Project Vasari work before, you can use a lot of climate information to drive a parametric model, right? So in this case, we have a windrows for a specific location. We have things like the computational fluid dynamics, the Ecotech wind tunnel tool. And then on the right, we have conceptual energy analysis results, or energy analysis 360 for Revit results. And then, of course, at the bottom, we have, this is a solar insulation calculation. So based on your location in the world, some climate information, and where the sun is at a particular point in time, we can calculate how much energy is incident on parts of your building. So this is the one that we're going to focus on a little later today. So a little bit more about Dynamo. So, you know, really, it's got a lot of great potential. There's a lot that's going to come out of this tool, but it's a little bit fragile, as we said before, a little bit moody right now. So you might crash if you use this tool. It's very much an alpha level code, but it's progressed a lot, I can tell you, over the last year, and even since it came out on the open source scene around 9 months ago. So kudos to Ian Keough, who is now one of our colleagues inside of Autodesk, though this is an open source effort that you know, he started a while ago while he was working elsewhere. And also kudos to Stephen Elliott and others inside of our organization now for working on it. So let's jump into it. So first thing you want to do to get into this is, presuming that you've actually downloaded this in the first place, and you can download this from the Project Vasari website on labs.autodesk.com, and there's a bunch of other ancillary information there on how to install. But once you install it, either for Vasari or for Revit, and then relaunch the application, you'll see this nice little new icon in the add-ins. So if I pop over to Revit for a second, or Vasari, so in my add-ins tab, I have this nice little Dynamo guy. And if you launch that, what you'll see, I'll just go through this live, it's a great little splash screen, visual programming for Revit and Vasari. And then here's the application that's sort of starting up here. So a couple other things we can talk through in this application. And this, if you saw this at Autodesk University, or if you saw it last fall, it's going to look remarkably different now than it did for you before, because we've changed the user interface and added a lot of new functionality in this kind of ever-evolving project. So that's it. We can run through that really quickly here. So basic idea, you know, comes up, and then you can load these workspaces and definitions that are actually the visual program. So quick thing about, you know, the UI and some other gotchas here. I mentioned this before, alpha level code. Things that will trip you up in this current environment is switching between active documents. So open documents is definitely an area that, you know, we need to work on and enhance in the application. So really the best practice is, if you're switching between things, you should close down Dynamo and reopen it. And then, of course, there's not all the Revit elements are supported yet. So these are just some basic gotchas and caveats that we have. We actually have people that are developing, you know, outside of Autodesk and Ian, new nodes, because it's open source, and sort of new concepts inside of the application, and they should start showing up in these builds shortly. So back to the user interface. A couple things going on here. So we'll talk about the pull-down menus. These are how you can load a particular file, and we'll talk about a lot of the samples today. A great new feature that we've added is the ability to search for specific nodes. So we have, you know, these guys here that look like little throat lozenges or something. That's what we call the Dynamo nodes, and then these are wires or connectors that connect things together. So what you can do is, like, and we'll see this in the examples later, is if you don't know the exact name for something, you can just type in, like, okay, I know I need to place a family. So you just type in FAM for family, and it'll sort of sort a list and filter based on what you type in. So you don't have to know exactly where to find something in the UI. So another new addition that we have is this idea of a node list, where you have this kind of left-hand pane that in a way acts like a toolbar, so you can start seeing what's there. But it actually acts more like a tool chest, where you can take a tool out and then drag it and drop it sort of onto your active canvas, onto the actual workspace here, which is pretty interesting to do. So you can start filtering things out, but it's not just activating a button. It's like you can literally just populate the thing you need into the workspace. So it's pretty convenient. And then because we're actually making a program, the thing here is this is actually an execution bar at the bottom left where you can run that program. So it's a visual programming environment, but ultimately at the end of the day, it's getting translated into something that is executable. And it can either be run explicitly, kind of manually, or run automatically, which we'll talk about a little bit later. And then Dynamo likes to tell you what it's doing as well. So it'll tell you when something is successful or something has failed in the status bar at the bottom. Okay. All right, so let's jump into it. So I've taught this a couple times as a lab session, so bear with me while I go more into a presentation environment. So the first example that we're going to go through, and these are all, by the way, built into the installer for this thing. So after you install the application, there's a new directory that's placed on your machine that contains a bunch of samples and definitions and things. So all you have to do is, instead of even loading something from the file menu or from Windows Explorer, just go to samples, one create point. And this is kind of the most basic example that we have. Talk about a few things in Dynamo right here. So as I mentioned before, these are what we call nodes. So something like a number here, you know, it's pretty straightforward, right? It's like, okay, if it's a number, what I'm doing is I'm typing in a value, and then when I hit enter or return, that value gets pushed through the system and goes downstream. So what's this number doing? Well, so you kind of read these things from left to right. So this number is feeding its value, its output value. So this port right here is called an output port. It's feeding that into the X and the Y and the Z for something conveniently called an XYZ. And this is kind of an internal concept. This doesn't actually make a Revit object yet. But its result is an object called an XYZ that can be fed into something that we can see on the screen, like a reference point. So what you do is you're basically saying, I want to put the value 0 into here, so you end up with 000, kind of like typing in 000 into AutoCAD or Rhino or whatever. And at that point, 000, make one of these nice little reference point guys. Okay? So pretty straightforward example. And this is actually a great point to bring up here. You'll notice that if I run this right now, nothing happens. Or if I pull Dynamo back over, it should tell me that this is an error. So it came back, this should actually turn red, and it comes back and says, family create can only be used inside of the Revit family editor. Aha! So the default sort of document that we have open inside of Vasari is the project environment. So what we need to do to actually run a lot of these that are going to be making points and surfaces and lines is actually run inside of a family document. So what we'll do right now is, if you ever get that error, all you got to do, you don't need to close this out, but shut down Dynamo for a second, and then go to the big V, the Vasari menu, and say new family. Okay? And then all you gotta do is just select a template. Doesn't really matter. We're just gonna use the generic mass.rft right here. And what this makes is, instead of a blank project document, it makes a blank family document. And that's kind of, for those of you that are familiar with Revit, it's not that big of a deal, but this can be a significant hurdle for people coming from other applications. So we're in a different type of environment that exposes a different tool set. So if you're just using this tool you know, yourself, that's where this family environment is, where you can make things like these form elements and everything else like that. You can't necessarily make those directly inside of the project environment. Okay. So what does that mean for Dynamo? Well, Dynamo speaks the same language that is exposed via the user interface here. So if we launch Dynamo back up from the Add-ins tab, now if I run that exact same sample, I'll get a nice little point. So same thing, just hit run, And behold, haha, there is now a nice little point object right here. Great. It's the same thing that I could have done just by placing one myself. So what does that really mean? Well, what it means is that you can actually start to control objects inside of a Revit document or Vasari document from an add-in, a visual programming sort of computational design add-in. And where that gets really interesting is if we start adding, you know, making a more complex definition here. So what I want to do is actually start making this dynamic. I'm just going to add another node here that's just called a number slider. So instead of using just a generic number that I'm feeding in kind of a boring 000 value, I want to make one of these dynamic. And the way that we do that is to essentially rewire the diagram, which, you know, if you've ever done any kind of plugging in of electronics to each other, you know, think about the back of a stereo, or if you've done anything involving, you know, breadboarding or wiring other little components up together, you're basically unplugging one wire. So by doing that, I'm just left-clicking on the Z input port on this XYZ. Just right-clicking on that and pulling it out into space. So that's like going to the back of your stereo and unplugging, you know, one of the red or white wires from your CD player, say, for example, on the back of your receiver. And now we're basically doing the same thing. We're going to wire in this object. So we're left-clicking on the output port of the number slider, and then just dropping it and left-clicking on the input port of the XYZ. And what we did there is just essentially change the inputs. So what does that mean? Well, that means that if you start sliding this around and re-execute, just re-hit run, you'll see this guy pop up because we're changing the input parameter into this formula. So as we've said before, we're reading this from left to right. So I've now said 00100 goes into this XYZ and then gets passed to the reference point. So just a couple other things around the UI. So I'm left-clicking here to drag the nodes around, and that can be used for convenience, you know, to make sure things line up kind of where you want them to do. You can also right-click and do things like delete, say, for example, and then you can use, in this case, I'm just using my middle mouse button on a three-wheel mouse to pan and zoom. So that, especially for a larger definition or a larger workspace, you know, you're going to be using that zoom a little bit. Okay. So one more thing I want to talk about here, which is actually really interesting, is this idea of running automatically. So what we can do here is, I don't know what it says. So as if this run automatically checkbox is set, every time you modify something either inside of Dynamo in the modeless dialog that's up here or out in Revit, which we'll see in a little bit later, or Vasari, the program actually re-executes. So, and this is actually pretty interesting to start to do, where now we can use this computational tool to feed information back into Revit or Vasari and have other things hang off of that. So you can have, think about it like a marionette, where you have certain control rigs that you can put in place and drive with another actor, if you will, and then have other things happen after that. Okay? So I'm just going to be moving forward relatively quickly here. So we talked about this idea of creating a point. Great, that's pretty exciting. If we go to the second sample, which is called reference point grid, or ref grid sliders, same concept. If you notice that as I loaded that up, my nice little point that I made before went away, and now I have an army of points that showed up here. And that's because I have this run automatically button set. So as it loaded up this sample, it executed it, took away the thing that it didn't need anymore, and made a bunch of new things. Okay?
Matt, can I interrupt with one question?
Sure.
We have a question about using the slider and kind of how you know what value has been attained from using the slider.
That's a great question. And that's something that we do hear about a lot. So a little bit about the slider node. You can edit any of the text here by just double-clicking on it and changing the value. So if I wanted to change that to, say, 10 from 20, you can do that. One thing that we have heard a lot from people so far is that this, how do I know what exact number that I'm at right now? So if I set this to be the middle, do I know if that's 5 or 4 or 3? And that's something that we're working on is essentially adding a tooltip or something on the right click to let you know from a user interface level kind of what the actual value is. So right now, there's not a good way to see that from this node, but you can see what that value is downstream by, you know, essentially what gets pumped out from, you know, from the actual node. Like in this case, it went from 5 to 7 from here. So that's something that we've definitely heard about and we're working to add on to in the next in the open source work that we're doing now. And a little bit about the open source is we're kind of treating this, this is all available on this thing called GitHub, just to diverge for a second. So if I go to, there's an open source repository under this thing called GitHub, which lets you basically put a whole project up online that people can download and use. So so this is under Ian Keogh's sort of space, and this is the actual thing that you can download and start building you know, from that environment. So what we're doing is actively committing to that, and then once we get to a stable state, we'll release essentially a new executable that, for those of you that don't code, you can just download and use.
Matt, is this, how up-to-date is this?
This is actual up-to-date, and you can actually see, you know.
With what you're showing now.
Oh, no, yeah. The thing that I'm showing now is available under the downloads section here, and it's also available from projectvasari.com. So this is from, yeah, about a month ago when we taught this class.
But if people wanted to start creating nodes or something or contributing themselves?
Yeah, what you'd want to do is we can do a follow-up session on how to get started on the actual development side of things. So if anybody's on the call that's actually interested in starting to develop, just send us a question. We'll follow up on that. So if you're kind of, if you just want to kick the tires and experiment, the best way to get into this is either from this GitHub site, which has a download link, and this works for Revit and Vasari, Revit 2012 and Vasari 2.5, or correspondingly from our space on labs.autodesk.com, there's a featured add-in area, and if you just click on that, it'll just send you to the download. And there also is, on if you click on the More section there, some great material that is the same material that we're going over today available just directly online. So if you wanted to run through the same examples, the same sort of background material, this is all available online right here on our wiki. So for example, like the example that we're going through right now, this create XYZ, behold, there's the same thing right there. Okay, and there's a step-by-step sort of how to do these things. So the two main sites that you want to know about is if you just want to kick the tires, you know, go to the main Vasari page here. If you're interested in getting a little deeper under the covers, then this is the actual spot where the code lives. And you can start to see kind of what, you know, what new things are added. So we've been adding a few things over the last week or so, and more to come. But usually what we do is we work kind of in an experimental stage, and then once we get something that works pretty well, we'll update the download version for both Revit and Vasari. Okay? So kind of back at it here. So we're back in this grid example. And we talked about the slider, so you know, you can set the base and sort of cap values here. There's a new node, a new player that we're working with right now, just called conveniently XYZ Grid. Pretty straightforward. So what it's taking in is essentially the number to put, you know, number of rows, number of columns to put in. The only one that we're changing right now is the X and the Y. And what we've done is you can actually make this a three-dimensional array as well by setting the Z count, but we just set that to be one for now, just to make one level of the stuff. This number right here is getting fed into essentially an origin position. So we're just basically saying start this at 000 right here and then propagate from there. And then the amount of space, the step in between these things, is being set down here. So X space, Y space, and Z space are all being set. So that's where you see this kind of rectangular array happening. And that's because, you know, one of these is at like 40 and the other is at 20, say, for example. So if you made them both 50, then you'd end up with a nice little square array. Okay? So you can see it's pretty dynamic. You know, it responds pretty quickly to your changes. And you can start to see in more complicated models how this is really beneficial. It's not encumbering your design process by saying processing, I have to keep up. You know, what we found is that this can keep up with designers' thought process, which is a pretty interesting sort of idea in its own right. So yeah, so the basic idea is you can read from left to right. So all these inputs go into the grid, and then the grid basically passes out an array of X, Y, Z points, and those are being fed into the reference point. And the reference point node will basically say, okay, if I have one thing, if I have one X, Y, Z, I make one point. If I get many X, Y, Zs, I make many points. So it's very flexible in what it can take in from there. Okay, so moving along here, I'm just going to go to another example. So this one is actually going to require a separate sample file to be loaded. So I'm just going to drop Dynamo for a second and then say open Vasari file. And when you install the Vasari, the Dynamo plugin, it actually puts some example files on your disk. So here we actually have a nice little Yeah, it's in my bootcamp directory. We have a nice little thing under C, Vasari WIP, and these have some sample files. So 2.5, Dynamo, and then we're going to go to samples, and we're just going to load a file just called mass with two curves. Just kind of a convenience thing. So this is a family that just has two splines in it that are just kind of pre-created here. So once we have that file open, we're just going to hit Dynamo again.
Matt, just one question real quick. All of these examples work only in the family environment, right? You can't use them in the base family environment right now?
That's correct, yeah. So there's a limitation in Revit that you can't run API applications inside of in-place families. So while you can make inside of in-place family points and lines and surfaces and forms, you can't access them via the API, the Revit API that we have. So that requires that if you want to work with those types of objects, you need to be in a what's called a loadable family, an RFA file. That might change in the future, but for now, that's kind of a platform limitation that we have. Okay, so let's go to sample three, just kind of moving somewhat quickly through this. I did mention that this is kind of fast and furious. Couple things are happening here. So now we have some lines to deal with, but what we want to do in this sample is talk about not just creating things from scratch using Dynamo, but taking things that already exist and referencing them. Okay, so this is a case where you can start, again, reading it left to right. We've got a nice new node called curve by selection, and a curve is just any kind of generic, you know, line object that we have. And all I'm going to do is just select that. So I'm just going to hit this button right here to select a particular object. Once it worked, then it'll tell us basically the element ID of that, which is somewhat not meaningful for end users, but it basically tells you that it's, you know, it has something to hold on to. We have a number, and then we have, very similar to the XYZ grid, we have an XYZ array. So if you hit run on that one, we get a nice little array along a curve. And what happens here is as you modify that spline, because you have run automatically set, it will actually re-execute that script and maintain these nodes that are being created by Dynamo in their proper position. So it takes that curve, that spline, divides it up into, in this case, 21 or 20 different spaces that make 21 different elements. And then, of course, you can, you know, slide that up or down, and you can see it's pretty responsive.
So, you know, at that time you added more, but if you're just modifying the spline, is it deleting and recreating the ones, or is it modifying existing ones behind the scenes?
It's actually modifying the existing ones. So like in this case here, because I say this is like the, whatever, 19 or 29 that just got added right here, it will actually maintain the previous 21 and add 29 more. Okay.
So their IDs are the same.
Exactly. So from a reference standpoint, these references maintain their integrity. It's
so
not,
you host something onto them.
Yeah. So it's not destructive. In that sense, where it blows everything away and rebuilds it. So if I did actually set something here, like if I drew something on that work plane of that point, and then change this to be, let's go, down to 30, then you can see that that just slid along the curve itself.
Okay. That's actually something that's pretty that you just did, which was a combination of in-canvas work and maintaining relationships to what you're doing in the diagram, is pretty unique.
It's pretty unique, and it's also, I mean, it's something that, you know, we have, there are a lot of different tools that are being used in sort of these early conceptual design, computational design workflows. You know, some tools have something like this, in some other, and it may be really convenient, in other tools it might be fairly difficult and non-trivial to actually add that kind of behavior. So our basic premise is, you know, make the things that are hard now in the state-of-the-art applications easier, and make the things that are impossible actually possible. They might not be as easy as they could be, but at least they're possible. So that's the basic idea here, is that we're using Dynamo to essentially latch on and remember a certain object in the Revit document, and then we're creating a set of other Revit elements, in this case reference points, that are hanging off of it, and then you can use that downstream to hang other things from. So there's kind of this great sort of logic path through these things. So this is a what's called a user-created, you know, form right here that's on a work plane that is from essentially a native Revit reference point, but one that is being managed by Dynamo through the API. So you can combine a lot of, you know, computational workflows with ones that are really kind of direct modeling at the same time. Okay. So just moving on a little more quickly here. So we talked about this idea of holding onto these objects. There's another sample that just creates a surface from the same kind of curves, and you notice that as I loaded this other example called form by selection, form from curve selection, it blanked out my previous stuff, and you notice it didn't take away the thing that was created from this, but this surface is now not associated, so it lost the reference point, reference plane that is inside the reference point that's being managed by Dynamo, but it didn't delete it, it just says now I'm just hanging out in space somewhere. So we're just going to get rid of that guy for now. So the same thing here. So what we're going to do is just select these two curves, and you'll notice that we get a nice little lofted surface, a ruled surface through these two, which is great. I mean, that's exactly what you can do, you know, through the make form, create form object or tool inside of Vasari and Revit. So what's really happening here? Well, the goal of this exercise is to show that you can manage essentially lists of objects, where in this case we have two objects that are being held onto. And there is a notion of a container. Like if you've done any scripting or programming in the past, a list is kind of like an array or a managed collection of objects. So we're just adding two, essentially, curves to that collection and then passing that into another node called loft form. You could make, you know, 27 of these computationally, throw them into a list, and then pass them to loft form, and it would make a nice smooth lofted surface through them. And then this Boolean is just setting, like, if it's a solid or a void along the way. So pretty straightforward stuff, but this is an introduction to a new concept just called list that we'll use a lot more in other samples in the future. So moving on, another interesting, great new part of Dynamo is this idea of what we call a user-created node. And this is something that, you know, is really interesting. Like if you can think about things, if you're a designer and you can think about things computationally, but you know, you're not really into scripting, haven't really programmed in the past, don't have somebody on staff that can knock out a script for you, how do you start creating something that you can use like a new tool in a toolbox without learning how to use JavaScript or Python or, you know, VB or something like that? This is the way to do that. So what you can do in Dynamo is create what we call another node that acts like a function in a programming language or in a scripting environment. So the basic idea here is that we have a couple inputs going into this thing, and then this little guy right here with a little drop shadow around it, which is called graph function, is essentially a function that was created just using Dynamo. So if you just double click on that, pretty much all functions take in a certain set of inputs, and that's what these are here. So anything called variable are kind of the inputs into that function. Does a bunch of stuff in the middle, and then it outputs something at the end. So functions take in something, they do some calculations, they run through some basic algorithm, and then they put out a result or a return value. And the return value here is basically a list of points, basically. So we're think about this like if you remember, and I dated myself, I taught a class like this last week to people that are in college now, and I said, think about it like a graphing calculator. And they all looked at me like, what? What are you talking about? I'm like, well, so you're in a calculus class, you break out your HP calculator, and they're like, no, we all have iPads, you know, we use our computer for that stuff. So but think
all
about it. I know. So the old guy in the front of the room is speaking a different language. So anyway, so think about this thing like literally graphing out a function. So the main goal of this example is to plot essentially a sine wave. So all of this says, you know, I want to go from -1 to pi, and so plot along the period of a function. Doesn't really matter what the function is, and then break it into a set number of sub-steps. And the actual function that we're plotting just happens to be sine, but you could put in whatever you want there. So what's happening when you run this little guy is you get a nice little itsy-bitsy cute little sine wave right there. And it's pretty straightforward. It's like, okay, I'm taking an input and an output, and I'm going along that, and I'm running, interestingly, this graph function. And the result of that is a series of x, y, z points that basically have their z's clamped down to 0. And all we're doing is feeding in an x value that is changing and then calculating for that x value a y value that happens to be along the sine function, and then taking the result of that x, y, z, putting it in a big list, and then dumping it out to a reference point. So it basically says x start, x end, and then the step. So for each step, it's taking this function and plotting it. And then basically it's saying, take the result of that, combine the x and the y that are being computed. The x is being passed in, the y is being computed, and then feed in a z value of 0. So this combine is basically another one of these list ideas here that's being run through. And we can spend a lot more time talking about that, but that's the basic idea of these things, is that you can take a user-created function that somebody in your office might make, or you might make, and then put up online, share with other people. If you want to say, hey, here's my really cool Voronoi diagram generator, have at it, make that here, but then you can share that either inside of your office or your school or outside. Okay?
Now, one more question. Is there any copy-paste or hide-show options, or is that in
Those are other great examples. So yeah, things that we hear a lot about is like, you know, managing these nodes would really benefit from having both a box select function where you can grab multiple things at one time, and then also copy paste. So yeah, those are things that we have requests for, and it's in our backlog. It's in our stack. Hide we haven't actually heard about, and I'd be curious to hear more about that, maybe offline, if we can get a follow up kind of use case on that. Zach is thinking. Okay.
I'm assuming that means to whether or not you want it to be previewed in the screen or you want it to just disappear when you're running it.
But it's a little ambiguous. Like, does that mean that it's active, but it's still there, but it sort of isn't active, or is it simply just not visible?
I mean, it could certainly work with a temporary hide isolator.
Yeah. But yeah.
Could it be previewable?
Okay. So I'm just going to shift gears a little bit more. So we have another one of these that it's the same concept, but it's essentially making a scalable one of these, so these nice little guys here. So instead of having to zoom into this cute little guy, we actually have one that is actually controllable, and you can just basically control the period and the amplitude of the function that you're plotting. And you can do other things like, you know, changing a different range so it doesn't just make one kind of sequence through. Just wire it up in different ways, or even just connect different functions into that. You'll see that pass through. This one, you'll notice, actually has lines that are connecting through these things as well. One interesting thing that's happening here is that this is not like a sine wave, or this is not a spline that's being passed through these points. These are individual line segments that are being computed by a different user-created function. So we have our nice little graph function guy here, makes the reference points, and then we pass in that array, that list of reference points, to another one that's called connect points. So all that does is basically take that overall list and then take the first and then the ith value of that. So it basically says, iterate through that list. If you think about these things computationally, take the current one and connect it with the next one. So if you're n and then n plus 1 along there. So that's what basically the logic is inside of here. And, you know, once you get familiar with this concept, it's actually really, you can start to read it in the same way that you can a scripting language or a sort of programming loop along the way. And then you notice it actually does something interesting here. It uses what's called recursion to call itself. So we pass in an overall list of, say, it's like, whatever, 30 reference points. It does some work, and then it calls itself with a list that's a little bit shorter. So instead of 30, it has 29. And then it calls itself again, and each time it drops out one of the points on the list that it's already computed, and then passes the lines back out from there. Okay, so this curve by points is the actual line, the black line that you see. So this concept of recursion and iterating through lists is actually, you know, interesting computational ideas that are really powerful, and in fact, you know, pretty much sort of the cost of entry into getting into more complicated, sort of programming examples, right? So you can iterate through something, kind of taking a list and statically doing something, or use something like recursion to step through and call itself, call the same function over and over again. Okay, so how are we doing on time? Just going to fast forward a little bit. One last one here, this idea of, I want to talk about this idea of Python for a second. So, we have this idea of user-created nodes where you can start to create your own programs. I can't actually show Python because I don't have Iron Python installed on this particular machine. Okay, well, that makes it easy. I'll just show that. Yeah, I'm going to show the optimization one in a second. So basic idea with Python, and if you guys were on the last Vasari talk, was that Nathan was left two ago? Yeah, okay. So two Vasari talks ago, friend of ours, Nathan Miller, now from Case, talked about scripting in Python. Key thing here is that the same things that he showed using the Python shell from Darren Thomas, you can actually do directly inside of Dynamo as well. Using this Python script node, you can actually execute Python script directly inside of this application, and then combine that with things that Dynamo can do as well. So, example I was going to show, basically selecting two points that I've created, and then passing them into Python, which creates this straight line, and then plots out a sine wave, very similar to the one we did before, but just using this code instead of anything visual instead. So you can combine the best of both worlds along the way. And that works, you know, with other things as well. Like you can pass in a curve, you can pass in forms, you can do other stuff along the way. Here's a case where I actually have two separate lists that you're passing in and connecting the dots in between them. Okay, so check it out on your own. If you're interested in this stuff, I definitely encourage you to go to our labs page or to the wiki itself and try some of these things out using Python. It seems like a really popular topic these days. Okay, so now the coup de grace, if you will. So what I want to do is open up the last example. So it's a solar radiation project example file under samples. And this gives us a nice little basic massing context model. Two different masses here. One is essentially an in-place family that just represents kind of existing buildings. And the other is what's called a loadable family that is basically our new building design. And basic idea here is that we're going to run through and let Dynamo figure out the optimal case for how to rotate this building. You could also do something like change the angle, but the main thing we're trying to do is figure out, we want to put photovoltaic cells on the roof, and we want to figure out, given this urban context, what is the optimal position of that plane to collect the most light, not just for a particular instance of time, but across the whole year. So that's a pretty non-trivial problem. But again, getting back to the original idea that we talked about, we take a smart family, which we'll talk about in a second, we combine that with the solar radiation tool that we have and extract some information from that using the API, and then wire up new relationships and behavior using this visual programming environment to push the resulting information back into the family. Okay? So a basic idea here is we're going to load a new, we already loaded up the project. If I go back to, sorry here, I'm just going to load Dynamo. And then the last sample number 8, and it just needs a couple inputs from us. So first thing it's going to ask for is a particular family instance. And this particular family, if we just dig into that for a second, is a loaded family, as I said. It has a couple parameters in it that are actually useful. Let me see. Yeah. So here's the way this family is built. So Zach built this family a while ago. Basically, it has a rotation parameter and then has a way to change the angle based on sort of two different heights. So you can always maintain a certain square footage. It's going to try and seesaw itself into the right configuration there to maintain like your program area, say, for example. And then we can also add an increment parameter that drives the rotation. So this is kind of the standard sort of fill read layer cake example that we've shown, you know, in the past. That, you know, we developed this a long time ago for other architecture practices, but you basically change one value from 1 to 2 to 3 and you cause a rotation or some other change to the rest of the model via parameters. So that's the way that family works. So we're going to talk about how to wire this up with solar radiation as well. So we have this nice little parametric family that has some properties in it. We have Dynamo here that's just waiting, anxiously waiting to do something. And then we have this nice little analytical tool called Ecotec Solar Radiation that we're going to pop up. And all we're going to do with this is, if you guys have probably seen this type of tool before, we're just going to select the top surface of our nice little mass here. And you'll see a nice little rainbow show up of computing for this particular instance in time. Actually, sorry, this is already set to one full year here. Hey, you can see that for this particular example, we've already set it to say, I want to look at a full year. So this is the amount of calculation it's doing for us. So it's not just where the sun is at that actual point in time. And it's showing the results graphically on the screen. So the basic idea here is blue means not that much energy. Yellow means a lot of energy coming in. So you guys have seen this stuff before. And if you change the model, if you change the sun position, you know, these things will all update. One thing that we added over the last year is the ability to automatically export these results out. So you can export these results of this data. Like, think about this kind of like a grid of data points. They can be exported out to a CSV file. And I'm just going to put that on my desktop. Just name it auto. And all that's going to do is just give me a comma delimited file that has essentially all of these points that are already shown up there. So you think about this thing from like a, each one of these, the points on this grid can be represented as just a simple value. So that's what we just exported out to a CSV. And what we're going to do is just read those results back in using Dynamo. Just turn this back to a cleaner version. And then use that to feed back in after doing some calculations in Dynamo to drive the model. So we're going to first tell Dynamo about which family to drive. So we're going to tell it, hey, use this param building increment family instance. And then for the file name input, this is, again, really simple. We're just going to browse to that same file. It doesn't really matter the file name. Just remember where you put that file from solar radiation back out on disk. So here's my nice little auto CSV file. I'm just going to say open. And now it remembers, okay, here's my nice little file. And then, just in the interest of time, if you just hit run, and there's one more trick to this whole thing, which you actually still need to kick this file just a little bit. So change, there's an increment value, like I mentioned before, that you need to change from 0 to 1 just to cause the first change to happen. But what will happen when you, oops, have to hit run automatically. It should just work. File watcher timeout. Okay, so yeah, there's another little checkbox. After you do the initial export, turning on the automatic export. There we go. So let's kick it one more time. What do you think, Stephen?
It just looks like it took too long to calculate. Try you can try erasing the timeout on the file launcher inside of the loops. Is
Okay. Bear with me for a second. This, like I said, this is still early code.
So I'll just talk about one question while Matt's. Oh, you got it work.
There we go. So now it's working. It just seemed like, yeah, on this computer it was taking a little bit longer. So what we're actually doing now is stepping through, going from one increment all the way through the cardinal direction, or all the way through the compass 36 times. So we're incrementing an angle 10 degrees at a time and recalculating an analysis result. And then using that analysis result, holding on to that total cumulative value here. So we're dumping out each one of those sample points, holding on to that information, adding up the amount of energy that's incident on that surface for that particular, you know, state of the model across the full year. And as we step through them, we're trying to remember the maximum version of that. So this is running a little slow, I guess because I set the timeout to 10,000. Yeah, there's something running a little slower. Yeah, it's just running a little slower on this machine for some reason. But, you know, you can see it's kind of, I'm not doing anything here. This is the program running through, you know, a design space of, okay, show me, run through these different options, which is something that, you know, computers are good for. And then when you're done, what I want you to do is find the version that has the most amount of incident solar radiation. So as we get closer to 36, what will happen here is that Dynamo will now switch over to what it found to be the most, based on the goals that we set, the one with the particular increment value that has the highest resultant value of incident solar radiation, which is actually, you know, visible graphically as well. Like, you can see that some of the other variations on this had a lot more blue. So this one has, across the overall surface, you know, a lot more yellow and orange and red than other examples. So what we found here is that for this particular site, and across a full year of time, so as the sun traces up and down the analemma and rises and sets, this particular angle and rotation are in fact optimal for, you know, essentially capturing the most sunlight, if you think about it from like a sunflower idea. Okay? So with that, we can get into a lot more, but we're right at the time, and I'd like to open it up for questions at this point. And since we started, we also have Stephen Elliott, one of our colleagues here, who's instrumental in making a lot of this new functionality work.
So we actually probably should wrap up very soon, since we are at time.
Okay.
I just want to take one last question. There was a question about opening this visual scripting up to energy analysis results. So can we connect visual scripting with the energy analysis stuff that's up on 360?
Yes. So the answer is, so if you use any of the energy analysis features that are inside of Vasari, the calculations are being done with the DOTU engine in the cloud, but we also have a what's called a local cache of that information that's run, that is kept locally. And that's how you see things like in the results and compare dialog, all the graphs and more importantly, the underlying information also exists on your local machine. And you can write a node or even a little script that's going to parse that information and pull out something like the energy use intensity, say, for example. You can read the results and do something with it. One thing you can't do via the API right now is execute a new run of the actual energy analysis, the conceptual energy analysis. Okay. So we are at time. We're a little bit over. So I want to thank you guys all for your attention today, and look forward to any follow-up questions. Feel free to post them on projectvasari.com, like we mentioned before, and we'll start another level of dialogue on how to combine computational design tools with energy analysis and parametric modeling. Okay?
I'd also encourage you to check out the wiki. I put a link in the chat section. All of this that Matt talked about today is documented under the Dynamo section there. And we will also have a poll at the conclusion of the webinar, which will allow you to give us more feedback and also enter your AIA number if you would like to get credits for today. Thank you, everyone, for attending.
Thanks, everyone.